Welcome to the special edition of the AppDevANGLE. We have some news in the observability space about Palo Alto Network acquiring Chronosphere, a $3.35 billion acquisition. It's indicating a massive shift in strategy and also a bold message for the future of AI demands for observability and security of becoming lock and step. My name is Paul Nashawaty. I'm the practice lead and principal analyst for the AppDev practice. I'm joined by Bob. Bob, how you doing?
Doing great. Thanks for having me on, Paul. Appreciate it.
Always great to have you on, especially right when you just got off a red eye. So it's you're bright and fresh. That's awesome. But awesome. I mean, Palo Alto, right? This is great. It just shook up the industry with this $3.35 billion acquisition or announcement of Chronosphere. It really is signaling, I think it's signaling a major shift for the unification of security and the next gen observability, right? This is just isn't about scale. It's about really power, you know, powering the AI era resiliency with real-time telemetry, autonomous investigation, and agent-driven remediation. So I think in this special edition, we really need to break this down for what it means for customers, competitors, and the future of just AI native infrastructure. What do you think?
Yeah, I think there's so much to unpack with this acquisition. I mean, certainly we're seeing that trend, I guess. Like, you know, one's a data point, two's a trend. So we saw Cisco acquire Splunk, $28 billion, really strategic move for them. Part of their platformization of all of Cisco. So instead of just independent business units, let's tie everything together, networking, security, and observability. So it's great to see Palo Alto, who is sort of on that same thing of like, let's build a security platform. Let's also, you know, one of the key factors as organizations and their environments are becoming far more distributed, far more complex, having that observability is really going to be key to helping to feed any of the agentic AI pieces and be able to feed any of the ability, the security tools and so forth going forward.
Yeah, I mean, when we look at this, it's a strategic shift in my mind. I mean, observability does meet security. We know that, like you mentioned, Splunk and Cisco and bringing those tool sets together, that tech stack together. We mentioned, you know, we see this happening. There is a consolidation in the market around observability and security coming together, but let's talk about why Palo Alto Networks, it's traditionally known for cybersecurity, right? So, but they're making a big bet on the observability front, right? So according to the press release, we see that there's a unified data and security foundation is what they're aiming for, right? I would say from the perspective of modern application and AI workloads, that's a good part, but we're also, I think that there's a piece missing here, and it might be part of their go-to-market strategy, but I think the networking piece is also missing. What are your thoughts there?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, as I think you're spot on, this is all driven by the AI era, right? There's so much more demand on organizations. The environments are so much more distributed that when you look at those different piece parts, that you need to have, you know, before anything gets done in the AI world, one of the top concerns is security and that ability to have resilience. We've seen organizations that when infrastructure goes down, it creates issues. So being able to have that visibility, being able to shift from being, you know, reacting to issues to being able to spot trends and be proactive by having that data, right? And data is really the lifeblood of AI. So I think not only is this for the AI era, but I think this also, Chronosphere has some really interesting agentic capabilities that I'm sure Palo Alto would love to have and not just use for observability, but integrate into their security platforms as well. And now they've got so much more data that they can leverage that they're collecting all the telemetry and so forth, telemetry from the network. And Palo does have a little bit of networking, right? They bought CloudGenix, so they've got the SD-WAN. So they're taking a look at that. But it does bring up an interesting, you know, obviously Palo Alto is very acquisitive as a company. And so I think it was something like 22 acquisitions since 2014, about 10 since just 2020. So it does make you wonder if there are potential, you know, once they get this digested, if there's a potential networking acquisition as well for them. So that remains to be seen.
It does remain to be seen, but it absolutely is going to start with that kind of building this huge competitive landscape. All right, so let's talk a little bit more about Chronosphere. I've been following Chronosphere for many years. In fact, last week I was at KubeCon talking to Martin Mao. You know, we were hanging out at their Cheers to Observability event that they had that evening, which was really cool. Thank you, Martin. But also, like, we're talking about build for this AI era. I want to kind of double click on that. Well, what you mentioned there, you know, Chronosphere was built and designed really from day one to handle scale telemetry, the density issues of the data, but also data costs in the AI native environments, right? So this is really kind of interesting. I used to joke a little bit saying that the number one consumer of storage was the observability teams because they stored a bunch of information with their logs and didn't know what to do with it. Now we're seeing like companies like this Chronosphere solution is really kind of coming in going, okay, we can do logging, tracing, we can do all the melt pieces, we can do, you know, the alerting, et cetera, all of it that kind of comes together. And I think by highlighting it, taking the actionable insights, you know, with that you get from the telemetry information, also leveraging, you know, open source with OTel, right? It really helps with that, you know, scalability that we see with the solutions, right? And in Palo Alto, on the other hand, they already highlight that they handle petabyte scale data protection, you know, that supports very large cloud native AI workloads. So there's synergies there. I'm curious if you think that there's, you know, maybe a growth opportunity other than the networking side, but a growth opportunity in the observability side and a growth opportunity in the security side as well.
Yeah, I think absolutely on both counts. And you brought up the, you know, that scalability. When I think about observability, a lot of times my mind goes back to the modern applications and the need for observability being driven by the fact that your infrastructure could be changed, and, you know, things spun up in just a mere seconds. So you needed to be able to monitor everything, right, in order to get this, instead of the old quote unquote monitoring days, which is every 5 minutes or something. So that was the genesis of it. But then when you fast forward into this AI era, and you brought up a really important point, which is scalability. And so, you know, when we look at what's going on in this AI world right now, you started with scale up, and then it went to scale out. And now we're seeing scale across, where organizations are there because of some of the power requirements, they're having to build regional GPU clusters. And that scale across technology is going to enable that, basically the network that's going to connect to dispersed GPU clusters. And again, because of the criticality of that infrastructure, the cost of the infrastructure, the cost of not having it fully optimized and utilized, you're going to need to have the telemetry into that environment so that you can ensure the resilience of it, so you can ensure that it's always optimized. And most importantly, leveraging all that data to ensure that all that data is secure, especially as organizations, you know, that there's always been that trade-off. Are people going to use all the public models, or are they going to do it themselves? And just for the data cost of moving it all to the cloud, you're hearing that once the enterprises take on, they're going to be doing a lot of this in their own data centers. And certainly when it comes to inferencing, they'll be doing it, a lot of that in their own data centers or at colos close to their locations. So it creates, you know, we've always talked about this, as organizations became more distributed, it just creates a greater security threat and a greater security threat landscape. And so the need to have the data that can feed not only just for resilience and so forth, but also for security is going to be super critical in these large, complex AI environments.
Yeah, I think that the other main factor here that we have to kind of take into consideration is security does fixing a problem, if you, you know, addresses and maybe even hopefully prevents a problem. But there's also autonomous remediation that has to be taken into consideration, right? Chronosphere last year at this time had a number of big announcements, right? They had a number of things around logs, around tracing, around like basically expanding the Chronosphere ecosystem, bringing in new tech stacks, mergers, and bringing in different areas. The Cortex AgentX platform for running AI, you know, agents for observability data is really a big factor here. But adding Palo Alto on top of it, that really adds the fact that these agents cannot just detect performance and security issues anymore, but they have to autonomously investigate root cause and remediation, right? Agentic remediation, so to speak, right? And that's a factor that I think the combination of the two companies is really going to be powerful, right? So if you consider what this means for an always-on resilient, you know, AI systems, there's fewer blind spots and faster recovery. That's what we're looking for, is an MTTR of, you know, if you have something that happens in your observability solution, you have an actionable insight that occurs. Yes, I'm still a big proponent of a human in the loop, but I do want to be able to push the big green button to take action. What are your thoughts there?
Yeah, so 100%. I mean, AI and agentic AI is the new wave of the future for doing operations. But I do agree with you 100% that the human in the loop is going to be critical. You know, obviously, I cover a lot of the network space as well. I just saw a stat this week saying that, you know, about 25% of all network engineers will be retired by 2030. And so that's a hell of a lot of talent that's going to be leaving the workforce. And so you really need to be able to get their insights while you can. So having those humans in the loop today to be able to, I guess, validate that what the AI is telling you is correct, being able to provide the actual remediation when it isn't, is going to be super critical to driving up the accuracy of these tools. I mean, a lot of the organizations I talk to might be at that 80% range, you know, moving towards 90%. You want to be in that 95% if you can. And there's always going to be a human in the loop to do certain tasks and help to be able to remediate certain things. But certainly, you know, having that information, as you said, helps move organizations from being reactive and time-consuming problem resolution to just getting to fix the problem as quickly as possible and to drive availability as much as they can, especially in these environments that are obviously, any downtime is going to be hugely expensive for them. Not even considering what the impact might be to their reputation and so forth. So being able to deploy these solutions, making it easier to deploy these solutions, and by that I mean the security and observability solutions across the entire environment, be able to collect the, you know, not necessarily even all the data. I mean, you obviously need to do that from an observability perspective, but it's really going to be about making sure that as part of this agentic piece is that you've got the right data at the right time to make the right decisions.
Yeah, you know, I mean, Bob, this makes me think of, you know, the statement failure is not an option, but, you know, failure is an option, right? It is an option. And I think that this gives us, you know, gives the market an ability to take steps regardless where you are in your maturity journey, right? That's a big factor here. So if you're early stage or if you're even fully mature, you have a solution here that can address the challenges and, you know, put that failure aside, which is really, really great. So Bob, I want to talk about the financial impacts and the market implications here, right? So the deal is valued at $3.35 billion, right? This is a paid a mix of cash and equity, right? We see that Chronosphere has an ARR reporting of over $160 million earlier in September this year. That's triple digit growth year over year. That's impressive for the company, right? That's really impressive. So we're analyzing like the potential investor. I am not a financial analyst by any means, right? But I do know that this is a big impact, right, to the market, right? So such a large acquisition, it does raise the question about how Palo Alto's capital allocation and is that, you know, what does this mean for their long-term play? What are your thoughts?
Yeah, I think you're right. I mean, anytime there's an acquisition, there's obviously risk involved. 21 times ARR is a lot. So I think there's definitely going to be, I think that's more on the executive leadership team, right? There's going to be expectations of growth and so forth, and there's going to be a lot of pressure on Palo to deliver. That's something that we're just going to see as it plays out over time. I think from the more technical side, as you're talking about a platform, you know, and I'm sure they've done their due diligence and their research and so forth, but the next thing that people are going to be looking for is how long does it take to integrate into this platform? Right. And being able to merge that observability into the Palo architecture and their ability to leverage the agentics, the AI, the agentic AI engine that they have as well, I think is going to be really important. And a lot of people are going to be watching that to see what happens. I think for the enterprises, you know, certainly the promise of this deal is very compelling. And then, you know, what they're going to be wanting to see is that, you know, fully integrated solution when that's available and when it's mature so that they can, again, no one wants another tool in their portfolio. They want to be able to reduce them and take some out. So if you can you're already a Palo customer and you're able to converge onto this single platform, and there's what I always like to refer to as the principle of least astonishment as you're going through all those Palo Alto tools, I think that's going to be a benefit and drive efficiency for a lot of organizations.
No question. I mean, in our app dev research, what we find is 75% of respondents indicate they're using 6 to 15 different tools for observability solutions alone. And 54% of the respondents indicate that they are in favor of moving to a unified view. That's to reduce the TCO, reduce the complexity, and also address skill gap issues. But, you know, one of the things you touched on, I think, is really interesting. The AI-driven infrastructure and resiliency. This is really going to put, I think, merging these two tech stacks together is really going to put the tests in place of, you know, agent and agent delivery. How quickly can we use agents to do merge the tech stacks and make it work well together? I think the deal itself is really signaling how essential observability is really becoming an AI infrastructure, really for real-time performance, resiliency, and cost efficiencies, right? We see that connecting to, this deal really to broader trends in the market as well, where we see enterprises are building more AI native workloads and they need security plus data operations in tandem. The data is the lifeline of the business. If it's not working and if it's not accessible and if there's issues, obviously, that's something that we need to take into consideration. And then we also want to look at the competitive landscape here, right? What does this move mean like to Palo Alto against both traditional observability vendors like Datadog and Dynatrace, and security, cybersecurity firms making AI plays? There's a lot of shifting that's going on. I think you touched on it earlier with Splunk, but there's also a whole other ecosystem that is, you know, potentially being impacted by this. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. I mean, Datadog, Dynatrace, Elastic, etc. You're looking at this saying, okay, well, how do we play? You know, and a lot of times organizations will do this via ecosystems, right? Because it's hard for one. There is no one platform, right? We used to have the one dashboard for everything. And now it's, you know, everyone's moving to the platform approach. So the reality is there's always going to be an ecosystem of vendors. The question is, when does it make sense for those individual vendors to become functionality under a bigger part of a platform? And so if you're an observability vendor today, you're waking up and saying, okay, what does this mean for us? How exposed are we? What do we have to do to strengthen either our relationships or look to, you know, where we're going to partner up and deliver this combined functionality and additional value, right? Because the ultimate value of this is that it's going to be 1 + 1 = 3. Now, I've seen some of this happening at Cisco already, you know, with G2 coming in and doing the loosely coupled and tightly integrated across the networking team, across the observability team and the security team. And they are rolling out solutions that are delivering value to organizations, and they're trying to add the agentic AI as well across that platform. So we're definitely, now we're seeing the same thing with Palo Alto and with Chronosphere. So like I mentioned at the beginning, so we're definitely seeing a trend towards the platformization of all these technologies. And I think organizations are absolutely going to have to respond and think about how they are managing their environment. And again, it's not just themselves integrating, but also making sure that as part of that ecosystem, they're still integrating with like ServiceNow and so forth and any of the cloud providers. So like I said, there's a lot of work to be done, but I think the potential benefits certainly outweigh any of the potential risks.
Yeah, Bob, it's always insightful to have you on and have a conversation because we always can kind of double click down, and I'm sure we could talk for hours on this, but you know, I definitely think that there's big things happening here. I am super excited for Palo Alto. I'm even more excited for the Chronosphere team, Martin and the team. You've done a great job at building a great company. I'm really excited for you for that. But Bob, thanks for joining me today as a guest. And I definitely want to thank all of you who've tuned in. We really do appreciate you being part of this special edition of the AppDevANGLE and community. Super exciting times for the observability space. But for now, that wraps up this episode. We have a lot of data to share here, so feel free to reach out to myself, reach out to Bob, reach out to theCUBE, and we'll definitely share with you a lot of this information. But stay tuned to the trends that are happening and shaking this market. It's never a dull moment, so it's really, really cool. So be sure to follow us on social if you have any thoughts, questions, or just want to connect. Until next time, stay curious and stay building.